And welcome. This is another of our, what we're calling our SUNY Best series of workshops that we're doing free to the public. And the idea of these workshops is to present some materials that'll be interesting to small businesses, but also sometimes large businesses that kind of overlaps. And just to get a conversation going, get things happening, we're trying to do these on approximately a monthly basis. Sometimes it's 6 weeks between, but thereabouts. My name is Marv Meisner, and my role here at the college is Associate Director of Professional Development. And that means a lot of things. It's a very broad role. But one of the things I do is coordinate this series of workshops. Today we're very pleased to have Michael Frenchell, and I think Michael has met most of you when you come in, probably emailed you before the meeting in some cases. He's the Executive Director of the Community-Based Business Incubator Center. That's a mouthful, based out of Albany, New York. And he'll be talking to you about what he does and his organization. And the subject for today is going to be Value Innovation Works. Basically a process for innovation. Now I spent almost 40 years working in large manufacturing companies. And we always struggled with innovation. You know, we knew we had to innovate. You know, some companies they call it innovation, some companies they call it invention. And in a lot of companies, especially big ones, they call it research and development. And we always struggled with that. It always cost a lot of money. It wasn't a very streamlined process. A lot of times it didn't get the results we want. We'd spend a lot of money, get far down the road, and then find out it didn't work for some reason. And here we've invested a lot of money in it already. So we're always looking for a better way when it comes to innovation. I read the book, Dick Lee's book, probably almost a year ago now or 9 months ago, and it made a lot of sense to me. Really made a lot of sense to me. It's like, wow, why aren't people doing it this way? Because it really, your probability of success with innovation is going to be much greater when you use a process. And I think this is a great process for that. So, as a way of introduction, you want to kill all the lights here, Mike, and we'll start your video here. Just the switches, just all the switches.
All the switches?
Yeah. Thank you.
Good morning. I'm Mike Franchell. I'm the Executive Director to the Community-Based Business Incubator, which is a much too longer name, and I have to go out and change it to the DBA and make it shorter. It's a not-for-profit, a 501c3. I'm not an attorney. I'm not a physician. I'm a volunteer. I am not paid. This is my cause. We are a group of businessmen and women with a lot of experience who want to accelerate economic development in upstate New York. I would like to hand out to you something that Mark Barbano put together for us. Now, if I give this to you to hand it out, you won't fall?
No.
Okay. This particular email that Mark sent to me tells you where we are in the Mohawk Valley. Let me tell you just a little bit about my background. My background is I started a $50 million a year business in Syracuse. It had an 18% return. I've got a clinical chemistry, pharmacology, immunology, endocrinology, and biomedical background. Now that sounds like I'm from Boston or from New York City. I'm not. I was born in Oneida, and I was raised in Munnsville. If you are really from here, you would know where Munnsville is. I am a farmer. And I operate under the same ethics as a farmer. Here is an article that we have had published in the Central New York Business Journal. And again, we're advocating changes to the way in which we work with businesses in upstate New York. The Mohawk Valley has lost over 1,000 jobs in the last 18 months. We can reverse that with this concept. Again, I'm not paid. For you to be here, for you to come here, is an income to me. I have relatives here. I would like to see the gross domestic product for this area go to 5% and be sustainable. I'm working on from a new computer, so we're going to talk about value innovations, which is written by Dick Lee. And value innovations, I ran across him on LinkedIn. I called him as an author, and he talked to me. I don't know if you've ever called an author of a book. They don't talk to you. What I have been doing in business are some of the things that I saw what he was doing, except he's put it together in a process that is easy to understand. He's taken the customer and brought the customer to the ideation process. And I will cover the first four chapters. I'll do it quickly because we're short on time. I have books. If you need a book, I'll loan you a book, I'll sell you a book, I'll give you a book. Now, value innovations, I have to read this to you, being presented to you by CBBIC, SUNY IT, and the SBA. And I very much appreciate the fact that SUNY IT and the SBA are more than willing to work with us. The goal of this presentation is for you to identify your most important customer and their unmet needs. Now, let's ask a question. The term innovation, value innovation, those terms mean a lot to different people. Could I ask somebody to give me their definition of what innovation means to them? There isn't a quiz here.
Taking an existing product or process and making it better.
Yes, that certainly is part of it. As an independent contractor, what would you consider innovation?
Deborah? Improvement or adaptation.
Excuse me?
Improvement or adaptation.
Absolutely, certainly. Mark?
I'm a civil servant.
That's okay, but innovation can apply in your personal life in numerous ways.
Creative solution to a problem.
Could you say that again?
Creative solution to a problem.
Creative solution to a problem, yes. So, innovation has a lot of different connotations to it. Now, Dick Lee talks about value innovation, and everything that you said is correct. We've got a slew of innovation gurus who publish books, and I didn't realize that RPI, which is down the road from where I live, actually has their own innovation theory called Radical. They don't use it. Dick Lee is in the value innovation group. He's worked in four different industries, been a consultant for 15 different companies. He has an enormous span and enormous background. Here are some of the books that you'll see on the marketplace. Blue Ocean Strategy is the one which has been sold the most, but it lacks. It lacks the how do you do it, and what do you do next, and how do you get to the end point. It's really good on idealism, a little bit too academic, but it sold 43 million copies. Now, you've got all sorts of politicians who talk about job creation. And this is regardless whatever party or wherever you are, they talk about job creation. But they don't know how to create jobs. The Community-Based Business Incubator Center on every company that we work with and every company that we assist, they have to commit to have 50% of their employees coming from upstate New York. You must hire veterans and you must hire from the unemployed. And we have companies who have agreed to this. Now, we have had startups inside of RPI say, hey, I don't want to work with vets. We said goodbye. We know how to create companies. We know how to create jobs. We know how to get this gross domestic product up to 5%. Value innovations is one of the ways to do it. Now, when looking at innovations, there's common themes. Ideas?
Sure.
Creativity? Yes. Value? And including your customer. And we're looking for, in this case, what's the definition that incorporates them? You'll hear me say this a lot when we talk. Value innovation definition is delivering exceptional value to the most important customer in the value chain all the time, every time. The most important customer could be inside SUNY. Let's say SUNY has an organizational problem with a particular area, so we can create an entire group to focus on that using the IW to find the resolution to the problem. Let's say the city of Utica has a problem, and we can create a group inside of the city of Utica to help resolve that problem. But if you're not looking at inside your organization, you're really looking at selling a product, doing something that is outside your organization. At Value Innovation starts with giving you a place to start. It goes over the process, and we'll go over part of the process today. And it tells you what to do, how to do it, and what do I do next. It provides a process, a set of enabling tools, and I'll be giving you a copy of that. A How to Do It guide, that's the book itself, and examples. I have three examples here for you. A toothpaste. I didn't bring toothbrushes, so you don't have to worry about that. I have a box back there that is worth $7 million. And I have a catheter situation, which I used to ask for volunteers, and somebody says, oh yes, I'll volunteer. But when they figured out what the catheter was about. And these are examples. Real life examples, current examples of showing you how this process works. This is the book, and this is the process that you would go through. This is the 10 steps. Would you give them each one? And we're only going to cover right up to 4. And then we'll go into the product. The steps are easy, they're rational, and they're real. Where I like this program is I created a brand new test in Syracuse called the HLA-B27. You don't need to worry about that. But I was here when I created it. I never went through all of these situations. I actually focused that test on rheumatologists. I thought that was the most important customer. It wasn't. Primary care was the most important customer. If I had this particular procedure at hand, I would have been very effective in working on it. This is the enabling tools that you've just received. I mentioned Blue Oceans. I deleted a lot of slides going over all of the other concepts just because of time. But Blue Oceans looks at new markets and new products. And one of the companies that we're working with is out of Syracuse, is AptoMatrix, which has got $7 million in FDIR grants. And that innovation doesn't necessarily focus on brand new products and brand new markets. I thought about this at great length because I've dealt in that area extensively. It really focuses on existing markets. When you stop and think about it, say, jeepers, what can I do with existing markets? Right offhand, you say, I don't think there's a lot I can do, but when you get done with this course, you'll see that there's a ton of things that you can do with the existing market. We have nanotechnology going up in Albany. There's $4 billion in it. They haven't produced a thing yet. But there's $4 billion. At Saratoga, there's $17 billion going into a chip manufacturing company. It's really made by Abu Dhabi. They own it. And guess what? You've got PC sales dropping. Wow, what are they making? They're making chips for PCs. I won't invest in that.
I thought they were making also chips for Qualcomm.
They are making chips for Qualcomm, but they're also making chips for PCs. Now, the issue is that Global Foundry is high risk. If you've got an existing market that you're working on, we can make it low risk. Value innovation applies to medium, small companies that provides you with tools and businesses, and you can help create jobs, and that's our interest. For small business owners, it has the tools that gives them the confidence they need for new things. How do we deliver value? Well, your business model. Can you change your business model so it's more effective? Package it. I've got a perfect example on packaging, two great examples. Can you change your packaging that you're doing so that it is more appealing to your market? Your delivery method, how you're going to deliver it. Or is there a process? Is it a new product and is it a new technology? Or is it a modified portion of the most innovative company in the world is Apple. And this goes back to 2011. I think Apple stock has dropped to 480 or something like that. These are all the things that Apple is. New business model, product design, checkout, service, delivery, simplicity, ease of use, store layout. The glass stairs, which you may have seen going to an Apple store, are patented. And they have the Geek Bar. Now, never really thought of this except Apple didn't really create anything. Didn't create the telephone. Didn't create the computer. Didn't create hardly anything of those products. They didn't make new product. They modified current product to make them more user-friendly. And you can do the same thing with the products that you're working with, especially with the type of thing you're involved. And I do think GlobalFoundry has to go into that direction, because they have to get into telephones, they have to get into cars. GlobalFoundry has to do some things that get them into other markets. Apple, if you've been listening to the local news, is being in a battle between Samsung. And Samsung does this program. Apple doesn't do the program, but it does it almost in a similar fashion. Looking at what is an organization, a value innovation organization. There are certain things that it must do to be that. It's got to deliver exceptional value to the most important customer all the time, every time. It will fuel sustainable growth, profitable growth. It increases the company value, and this is where we're home. It creates jobs. And where does value innovation fits in? Value innovation starts at the ideation process, but you go through steps where you bring the customer, who is 10 steps down here, right to the ideation process. And when you stop and think about that, if you're GE, and GE's right down the road from you in this unit, the research laboratory creates a product. Well, they then give it to marketing. Marketing says things about it. They then give it to sales. And the sales goes out and sells, we got a problem because it doesn't really meet the needs of the customer. So we go back into the research laboratory. What value innovation does is this. In the research laboratory, we do something called contextual interviewing to the customer as you're working on the concept. So that as you're talking to your most important customer, you're designing your product so that when it's done, it meets their needs. So that's radically different than what most companies do. Now, I don't know how many people have heard the term stage gate processing. 3M does it, larger companies supposedly do it. I'm part of an international group discussing innovation, and a lot of these major companies have their own processes for innovation, and it's often inhibitory. To build such a complex process for you to develop a new idea that you never get through it because they don't want to take any risk. So, stage gate processing often is counterintuitive for innovation. Now, value innovation assures you that you're going to be delivering the most important product in the value chain if the homework is done up front. Now, this particular program can be used for primary communication tool inside. It modifies your move through the stage gate process if you have one. It keeps the portfolio management review in process. Now, this is mostly small companies here, but stop and think. If your company starts to grow and you go from 5 to 10 to 15, you need to keep an innovation process involved. When I went to Denver and I went to the classes, I had product managers from companies where one company would have 50 employees and anybody above a certain level went to Dick Lee's class. And the 150th employee was in that class because value innovations was an integral part of this company's growth. 3 years ago, they had 50. Now they have 150. It's a Southern California firm. Let me talk to you a little bit about the end stage of the process called contextual interviewing. You go through different steps that I have in front of you. And step four is where you identify, this is what we're talking about, your most important customers. You call them and you set up interviews with them. You record those interviews so that you know what they're saying. And Dick recommends that you have 12 most important customers. I've listened to 5 different interviews an hour long. And you've got 3 sets of interviews you do with them. And the first set of the interviews are very broad open questions. What is it that keeps you up at night? That's his opening question. And if you've got 2 customers, you hear those 2 customers talking back and forth until they actually become friends, where you might have one here and the other one in Belgium or in England. One of the more fascinating conversations I heard was an American manufacturer who makes first aid kits is talking to an English grocery store and an English dress shop. The grocery store has 1,000 stores, the dress shop has 500. And the first aid manufacturer is trying to see, what do I do to sell my product to these companies? And guess what? They didn't care about first aid kits at all. The grocery store said, I need something so that when mayonnaise hits my floor and a customer slips on it, they don't sue me. What the contextual interviewing told the first aid company was, they're in the wrong market. The dress shop could care about first aid, the grocery store could care about it. When you get through contextual interviewing, it allows you to focus on value versus cost. I have different startup companies that I work with. Pipe Snapper is a wrench company, an innovative wrench company, and it's 2 welders who have put it together. It improves the efficiency of welding by 50%. And they are having difficulty in moving into the marketing phase. They probably have $200,000 already put into this, and they're running out of cash. Well, we met with the head of the pipe fitter and steam fitter union. Now, most people say, why would you meet with the union? Well, the steam fitters and pipe fitters union have the most extensive welding training program in America. If you want to become a welder, go through the training program. In the first 15 minutes meeting with the head of the union, he says, I want this product to be trained on. And the issue is value added. He says, you know, we charge more than non-union plumbers. But there's a value to us if we're 50% more efficient. Guess what? They are now training on Pipe Snapper's product. So value is what comes out of this program. Here's some of the theses that you may have heard about. You've got rule makers, you've got rule takers, and you've got rule breakers. And these are different sort of 3 types of companies that you may hear about. When looking at it by industry, depending upon where you are, and depending upon which neck of the woods you happen to be, you can see how these companies fit in. I would change some of the things. The rule breaker for consumer electronics, I would really change that to put Apple there. But in discussion with Dick and other people, they really feel that Samsung, and they may be right, is really the rule maker for electronics at this particular stage. Now, how do you reinvent your organization by looking at things that Hannah talks about? Well, you set unreasonable expectations. I would change that. I would say that you set expectations that are aggressive. If the economy is growing by 5% and your company is growing by 5%, no big deal. So you would want your company to grow by 6 or 7%. That would be a reasonable expectation. You want to stretch your business definition. If you're not growing and not doing what you want to do, start looking at a way to stretch it. Create a cause. I'm here in front of you because this is my cause. I'm not paid. I do this because I think I can make a social effect, an economic effect, and improve your well-being. Listen to new voices. Design an open market for ideas. You may have been involved with companies who said, do it my way. This is the way we do it. We don't want to look at that approach. If you've been in those companies, it's probably not a good fit. Since I've spent most of my life in startup companies, a startup company reaches a stage. We've got the product, we've got it doing it, you got to sell it. I'll give you an example. Organogenesis, not a company you've probably heard of. Made and manufactured human organs. And the first one was skin. So we would go to pharmaceutical companies and to cosmetic companies. Now first, Warner Lambert. I'm on the stage with Christine Hartnett, and there's a lady scientist in front of us, and she is mad. She is really mad. And you can see she's angry. I'll open up, bring out the first slides. And here we're talking about our skin, living skin equivalent. And I said, do you have a question? And she gets up and she faces red. And she says, you're using abortion byproducts. Now I know what she was mad about. I said, no, we aren't. We're using foreskin. And she sat down, thought, got up, and ran out of the room. And that's what we were using to create our living skin was we contracted with women. Once they had a baby boy, we took the foreskin, and that foreskin would grow in the skin to cover the entire walls. So you've got these people out here who might think certain things about what you're doing that aren't quite sure. Now, we were very open in addressing those issues. Lower the risk of experimentation. How hard is it in your organization to experiment? How difficult is it for you to do something that's different? Those are things that are important for us to grow in our state of New York. We must do things that are different and do it now. Make like a sell and divide? Well, okay. If we're growing, that makes sense. Pay innovators really well. I'm assuming most of you here are people who have an interest in innovation. Surprisingly, the innovators are not all interested in becoming wealthy. Many of the innovators are interested in making a change, making some social or some economic impact other than their own model. Admittedly, they become wealthy, but you do need to pay them if they're working for it. Here are some examples of value innovations by Gary Hamel's rules. Procter & Gamble, Samsung, your rule breakers, Remax. I'm not really involved in real estate, but the way they're configured for paying their reps is unique. Southwest certainly has its own group. And Virgin Group, again, I'm not really too familiar with. And here are innovative leaders, 8 criteria. I won't spend much time on it, I've got a handout for this. Now, 2005, though it seems like a long ways away, the average group stock increase for these companies, Apple was 163%. Google, 139%. Rolls-Royce, 89, Toyota, 64, Canon, 61. Those are all innovative companies. Google is 700, 800, I don't know how much it is. I don't buy Google stock, of course. I hope my 401k does, but it's done extraordinarily well. Now, here we're looking at another definition of companies. There's need seekers, there's market leaders, there's technology drivers. Well, what are they? Well, a need seeker is a company that focuses on identifying unmet or unarticulated needs. That is precisely where we're headed, is looking at what you do, who your customers are, and can we identify the unmet, unarticulated needs. Technology drivers, well, follows directions suggested by technology capability, leverage their R&D, investment, and drive breakthroughs and improvements. Here are some innovation pillars. R&D, technology, and innovation. I really question this because I have patents, I have started a company, but when you look at the total amount of money that goes into R&D, when you look at the total amount of money that goes into grants, you often don't get as much innovation out of it as we would expect. Design with design strategy. Do we have anybody here who's involved with design? Okay. Consumer marketing with consumer understanding. Now, out-of-the-box thinking with innovation may or may not be something that stops companies from failing. What is your company today? Are you a rule maker, rule taker, rule breaker, need seeker, market leader, technology driver? I didn't give that gentleman in the corner a name tag, but I would guess you're with Smart Technology. I think I made a name tag for it, which I can't find.
I'm sorry.
Is that you? Could you give me your name?
Dennis Kinnard.
Okay. Some of these things might help right home with where you are. Value innovators are need seekers, and that's where we're going to go. This will fuel sustainable, profitable growth. It increases company value and it creates jobs. Here are some of the companies that have used value innovations. They're all major. There's over 180 companies worldwide. An interesting point, oil companies. Chevron uses value innovations internally. Chevron is 50% smaller than Exxon. But if you look at the profit that Chevron has versus the profit that Exxon has, you will see on all the parameters that Chevron is more profitable on less revenue. What they did was they took value innovation and focused it on the drilling guys, the guys who did the drilling. How do we get more oil out of where we are? The dividend for Chevron last month was, I think, 90 cents, and Exxon was 50. And Exxon is twice the size of Chevron. Now, here are a couple of things of cars that are using value innovations. We don't have a Tesla dealership here. I did go to one. The car was $79,000. I certainly didn't think about buying it. But it has some interesting characteristics. Here you get 245 miles per charge. Huh. That's better than anything that's on the market today. And in the deal, in the showroom, you have one car. You have one salesperson who is not on commission. The Tesla Roadster, it build the brand, show electric vehicles are exciting. Production stopped in December 2011, and they've made, of this particular car, 2,100. Tesla will make 20,000 electric cars this year, and they will be the largest electric car company in the world. Their cost for their cars are both going up and down. Here is an interesting product. You may have seen it on TV. Battery-operated refrigerated cases. Good for fishing, good for hunting, but it's really good when you're looking in India, where you have a lot of rural areas and you need to distribute products that need to be refrigerated. This meets a need. We don't have too many people here who have to worry about this sort of transportation, but it's an idea, a concept. And we're not going to get into this today, but this is a value curve which shows you the different competitive products and then shows you what the new product should be. When looking at this value curve, it will help you define what your new product is. In your contextual interviews with your customers, you end up with where you started off, and then you end up with what they are saying you need to produce. Just in case you want to get between Syracuse and Utica quickly, we can throw you into a tube and shoot you off this way. Just an idea. This is the first step. I'm going to give you something that you could certainly take home and copy. And we're looking at goals and objectives. You probably think you've got them. In a sheet that I've given you, we're actually in stage one. We're defining the project and the mission and the objectives that you have. If you're a single one-person company, have somebody work with you. Have a partner so that you've got somebody to talk to about what you think your goals and objectives should be. You've received the enabling tool sheet, and this is the first step. This step is important for you to make sure if it's reasonable. Thank you, I have another one now. What I'm sending out to you is just a blank sheet, and here is a sheet which has been filled out by an actual company. We're going to discuss that company, not now, but towards the end. And you need an overall goal. You need to have reasonable objectives. You've got to look at when you're going to start, and look at when you're going to start. Stop. I'm part of an international group discussing innovation. Once a month, we bring on people from Belgium, people from India, people from UK, people from Canada, the United States. It is absolutely the most boring thing I have to do, and they are not going to meet their objective of coming up with a publication. But the team leader isn't controlling this group. I record the conversations and listen to it afterwards, but it's clear that the person who's controlling these international conversations just isn't focusing on using this particular process. Now, here are some goals that you could look at. You want to double the size of your business in 3 years, increase the number of plates served on weekends, decrease the time to complete performance appraisals. How many people have more than 10 people working for them? Performance appraisal. I had 253 people who reported to me, not directly, indirectly. Performance appraisals could kill you. There is a way to put it together so that it's efficient, it evaluates the employee and the true characteristics of the job, and this program will help you in that if you find it difficult to do those appraisals. Let's think about working efficiency in workflow and work processes. Well, you use this sheet to look at those and to decide what to do. Here's just a quick other company issue. In case you're growing banana trees next door, my wife and I have two coconuts we brought from Florida. We're trying to get them to germinate, and they have, but I don't know how far the palm trees are going to go. Here's an example where a company was trying to get rid of nematodes that destroyed the banana trees in plantations. And the out-of-scope issue was a new molecule. And the in-scope issues were looking at application method and formulation. So by using in and out-of-scope, that defines what you're really going to do. And they actually were very successful in getting rid of the nematodes without creating a new molecule. And chapter 2, you've got folder pack, we'll discuss that. Next generation performance assessment, I won't go into that. And purchasing processes. So these are all in your book. Now, once you've put together your project, mission, and objective, you then look at the chain, and I'll go over this, of where you sell your product. It's often not clear who the most important customer is. You may think you know it, but some of these examples will make you think a little bit about it. You want to develop as is, what you currently have, and then you want to go to best in class, what do you really need? And you go to the contextual interviewing, and that contextual interviewing might be just exactly like the first aid kit that the grocery stores could care less about. So the first four steps are really important in what you're doing. Value chains and value webs. Value chain and a value web is, where does your product really go? It identifies each company entity that's involved in buying or selling or using transactions between the original provider or the manufacturer or the end user. And the goal again is, we want you to find your most important customers. I work with LibreTech in Albany. Brilliant computer guy. Fantastically successful firm. He can't determine who his most important customer is. I work with Manfield Learning Center. They can't determine who their most important customer is. They make money, and they're profitable, but they could be more profitable if they could make that determination. Understanding a value chain or a value web is important so that you can see who the most important customer in the value chain is. This is interesting. I have zero mechanical talent, so if you have great mechanical talent, you will understand this probably better than I do. But here we're looking at manufacturing of auto parts, both America and Europe. The distributor is sold the parts from the manufacturer. In the United States, it goes to a jobber, then it goes to an auto dealer repair shop, and then the consumer. Who is the most important customer. There are three questions you need to ask yourself. If there's a question, if there's a problem or an issue with your offering, who's responsible for taking action required to rectify that situation? Who is it? Who stands to lose the most financially if there's a problem or issue in your offering? Who is it? Who is the most likely to recognize the value provided by your offering? Well, you saw that previous chart. To me, quite frankly, it was difficult to determine who that was. Now, here's a graph that you have in your book, and it's one that you should use with your product. And you want to look at who has to fix the problem, who stands to lose financially, who sees the value. Well, here, when looking at the auto parts, the auto dealer certainly has to fix the problem. Repair shop certainly has to fix the problem. And who stands to lose? Auto dealer, repair shop. Who sees the value? Auto dealer, repair shop. So, the most important customer in this value chain isn't the company you sell it to. The distributor is not the most important customer. This is the most important customer. Do we have anybody here who's involved with pharmaceuticals? Okay. The manufacturer sells to a small group of distributors, 20. The most important customer is the repair shop and owners, and they're the ones that have to handle the problem, not the distributor. And there are 300,000 auto repair shops. So, the issue is, if you're an auto manufacturer of parts, you need to focus on those repair shops, not on the distributors. If all you do is focus on the distributor, you are probably not delivering exceptional value to the auto repair shop. Now, here are some of the questions that you do in contextual interviewing. What keeps a repair shop owner awake at night? Belts and hoses? No. Where do I find trained mechanics? How do I keep my trained mechanics? How do I make sure we handle our customers personally? How do I follow up with customers? I won't go over a value web. I am a patent holder, and I own four patents in asthma, emphysema, reactive airway disease, a provisional patent, and dental implants. This is difficult to go through, and if nobody has anything to do in pharmaceutical or medical devices, I'll move by it. This is of India. Knee replacements are common, and I would assume you got a couple people in this room who have knee replacements. I have one. And here we're trying to look at who's the most important customer here? And this is India. Well, the pre-surgery patient is the most important customer. And Indian medical areas are much different than that in the United States. That the most significant influencer is the post-surgery patient. Not the doctor, not the company. It's what the post-surgery patient says. Now, here we're looking at fibers in vehicles. If a manufacturer makes fibers, it goes to a fabricator, a component manufacturer, a vehicle manufacturer, and a military soldier. And here we're talking fibers for vests to stop bullets. When you look at that chart, can you decide who the most important person is? Well, we ask the same three questions. Who has to fix the problem? Vehicle manufacturer. U.S. military? U.S. military stands to lose. Who sees the value? U.S. military? Soldier. These fibers are used for the vest, but they're also used for the walls of the vehicle. And the issue is, where they're really selling it to is they're selling it to the fabricator. And if you're a soldier, and I'm assuming we have some vets in the room, you sure as hell want to have a fiber that stops a bullet or stops a bomb from taking your leg off. Fibers used in vehicle armament go through this process, and the most important customer of the value chain is very difficult to see. It's the military, and you've got the manufacturer produces the best performing fiber in the market, 4 times better. Aha, got an advantage there. But all products must need military specs. The fabricator purchases the lowest priced fiber that meets military specs. Well, if you've got an armor vest on, which is 4 times better than his armor vest, you're going to want this armor vest. Do we have any vests in the room? Getting through the purchasing process with something which is 4 times better is difficult because it's more expensive. The manufacturer must meet with the U.S. military and share we have a fiber that is 4 times better but costs more. At the meeting, they proposed to set up a meeting with the military, the fabricator, and the value innovation team. The message? We want you to use this fiber. This is a true story. Cost is a non-issue. When you're talking difference between having to take care of a veteran with an arm gone, part of the face gone, you're talking millions of dollars. But if we've got a vest on him and armor on the vehicle, we can reduce the damage to the manufacturer must interface with the most important customer in order to play in this market. But the most important customer wasn't really obvious when you look at that particular chart. It's a fabricator. The fabricator in that case is not the most important customer. This is one more example. Do we have anybody who's involved in transportation? Okay. This is dealing with a temperature control unit. This came out, and in case you got salmonella from your chicken, which wasn't kept cool, it's going to Price Chopper or Wegmans, they had to figure out how to make these temperature control units so that they would meet the minimum requirements needed for the tractor-trailer truck owners. Well, this again is the same sort of problem of who is the most important customer. Here we're looking at parts and component manufacturer, Thermo King, dealer, installer, truck fleet, truck owner, truck driver, purchasing agent. Well, these people are way down the pecking order, and they're the people who have to handle situations with the refrigeration unit. So, again, we ask the same question. Who has to fix the problem? Who stands to lose financially? Who sees the value? Now, we've got the insurance, we've got the dealer, we've got the driver, truck owner, operations, truck owner. So, the most important customers, this is what they did. They designed it with input from fleet ops and truck drivers to address fuel cost, operating cost, driver turnover, 26 languages. Russian is the most common language spoken by our truck drivers. You never do that. I did do a study years ago about what truck drivers were taken for drugs. We put a truck stop in Nevada and one in Connecticut, but we never checked on languages. You've got a touch screen on the system, 500 temperature setting. It reduces fuel consumption. It's got a 4-year warranty. The three-question template, is there always a clear, most important customer? No. What do you do when the most important customer is in a large organization, a mass merchant, or supermarket? You must identify the person in there. The process is the same. Let me go to my examples. Did you bring a toothbrush? Toothbrush. This is from England. Could you share? Could you share? You've seen this. This is from retail. Would you share a box? Could I ask you just take a look at the box? This is Sensodyne. It's sold in England. It's very expensive. The history here is we have an inventor in Florida who uses calcium phosphate, who wanted to create a way to regenerate bone. Well, it worked a little bit, but we had a dentist who said, hey, calcium phosphate would be really great to be able to do dentine repair and tooth repair. Well, a company was created called Novine. Well, they had the calcium phosphate in the toothpaste, but no sort of fluoride. They were struggling to try to sell this to the United States. They finally figured they're going to have to sell out to somebody. Well, they sold out to Smith Kline in England. And there are three things you need to look at when looking at over-the-counter items. You've got something called the zeroth moment of truth. And women buy toothpaste. Men don't care. Women are primary market. The zeroth moment of truth is when you say, oh, I'm Smith Kline. Yeah, I use their products. I like them. That's the first point. Then you've got the first moment of truth when you look at the package. And on the package is what looks like a three-dimensional tooth. Well, it's really not three-dimensional tooth. It's a particular type of printing, fairly expensive, called Frenzel picture. And it encourages the person to buy the product. The second moment of truth is when you open up the toothpaste, use it, and you find that it works. Calcium phosphate is bioactive glass, and it literally coats the dentine in your teeth. So if you look at the micrograph, you see it's fairly got pitted. It is no longer able to have sensitivity and repairs of dentine. Colgate-Palmolive is losing market share radically in England, and this is coming in the United States in different formats.
So is this one of those man in the white suit kind of things where the industry doesn't want it because it will cause them to lose business?
I'm not exactly sure I understand the question.
Okay, for example, to use the analogy, there was a movie about it, the man in the white suit. invented a fabric that didn't ever have to be cleaned. But the textile industry realized quickly that if they put that product on the market, they would eventually go out of business because people wouldn't have to buy new suits.
Well, I don't think this is quite the same, but dentists are not going to tell you to use this. I actually bought this off the drugstore.com, and I'm using the toothpick. My dentist wanted to do x-ray my teeth, and I just had a dental implant put in, and I had enough people running around my mouth for a year. So I'm waiting a year to go see what this does, to see if I've got any cavities in the spaces between my teeth. I think this will probably reduce my cavity load, which is fairly low since I have very little dentine left. Now, here's an example on catheters, and this is exactly the process that we're talking about. This is the way catheters are generally sold in the United States. $2, you've got all the material you need in here, gloves, mask, everything about the patient. They're generic. Advantage, a company which was looking at how do we change this so that we have a unique catheter system, put the value innovation process together. And this is what they came up with. Where can I stand where you can see this? The issue is, we have a patient laying on this table, and we have a catheter in this patient. We take out the catheter, which is no longer sterile. You've got to leave the patient, taking the catheter, and depositing in a red container. That's the first problem. The second problem is things that are in that generic bag in a disorderly fashion that you don't need. So this company came up with this, and this is all patented. You open this up, and there is your mask. You put on your mask, and then you open up the package, and I'm not sure I could show this, but you have all of your products in sequence that you're going to need to take out the catheter of the patient and to put in a new catheter. Now, we still have the problem that we have that old catheter we want to do something with. That's why you have this bag. The old catheter, the old tape, and the dirty things are put in here, and you never leave the side of the patient. This has taken much of the market, and it's 4 times more expensive than the generics. I talked with 2 of the people who developed this, and Clorox just bought this company, but they may not continue this particular product. The reason I'm showing you these things is that these are current today examples of companies. This box is worth $7 million. The story with this box is simple. Venture capitalists put $7 million into a company. I think I've given you the Expandos project sheet. And the company was going out of business. They couldn't sell their product. And their product was a great idea. They took used cardboard to turn it into a packaging substance. I mean, you want to talk green, that's green. I'm glad that's not my pacemaker. Now, the company put value innovations to work, or they were going to go bankrupt. And here's what they have. They have little pieces of paper that are in a triangular shape that when put into a box will take the place of styrofoam and take the place of little bubbly things. Well, they sold out the concept to distributors. And the distributors didn't want to pay more for the product, so they were going out of business. They brought in Brad Fenn, I think is the way to say his last name. He knows the DIW procedures, and he changed who the customer was. This product. It's extremely strong and biodegradable, but he went to Amazon.com. He didn't go to the distributor. Amazon.com sells 1,000 TVs a month and loses several hundred due to damages. They now have this product in their 10 warehouses. I have glass and other stuff in the bottom. And
Mike, would you show the camera so the camera can see what you're talking about? The recording.
Okay.
No, just the what these things are. Show. Can you see it?
Yeah.
Amazon.com now has 10 machines in 10 warehouses in the United States where those machines punch out these at the end of a production line as TVs roll off the production line to be shipped. Out of 1,000 TVs a month, their breakage rate dropped less to 2. So this is where Expandos changed in the marketplace. And this is just recent. I sat in their office, I had to sign a confidentiality agreement. This is going to become, and is now, a very, very profitable company because they found the most important customer. Am I in trouble on time, Mark?
You are good. You still have half an hour.
Okay. Now, I have handouts for you, and these are looking at your own companies. Read them. See if your company is doing some of those things, and it says much about the combination of a good or bad company. I also have an evaluation form. You don't have to sign it, but if you wish to go to more extended class, fill out the back and give it to me. I'm not going to give you one, John, because I know it. If you want me to, I will give you the results of the survey. Now, with that said, I've done all the talking. Do I have questions?
I think one of the keys, and you kind of mentioned this, one of the keys to this product is the way it is distributed. Because Amazon has machines at the end of the line that actually make this product as they need it, and they can just fill the box. And that's a key issue, because if you try to ship this to somebody to use it or whatever, it just wouldn't be as effective. But they've got the machine, and they just fill the box right at the end of the line. So it's not only the product, but the way it's distributed. In this case, I think that's key.
The first set of machines that the company did were faulty, which I asked Tom to give me a manufacturer, and he gave me a manufacturer in Rome, New York, to deal with this company and to manufacture the machines. And they had a particular price that they wanted the machines to be below. I don't know where that's gone, but that's my role, to try to bring in business here in upstate New York. The issue with Expandos is that machine is punching out these triangular pieces of paper as Amazon.com is shipping TVs, and they have reduced their breakage rate significantly. And this is more expensive than the little, I don't know what you call them, little plastic things with bubbles, which I like to break all the time, or the styrofoam beads. So this has found the niche market. And this company, that's something I need to pay. This company, I sat in their office, I looked at their equipment, and the CEO was very honest. And he said, we had to make a decision. We either were going bankrupt or we had to change. So this is why I believe in this particular concept. Again, I'm not paid to do this. I'm not paid by Value Innovations. I'm not paid by anybody. Matter of fact, I can't even invest in companies in the state of New York because they bring me CWIC. So if I work with you on your company, I do it as a volunteer to try to help you.
What else do you have in the box?
Excuse me?
What else do you have in the box?
You know what? I forgot with the garbage bag because I have so much paper. Let's see if I can use this. Came out of Denver. I have a light bulb. I got a coffee cup. And I got brick.
Oh, God.
So, this stuff really works. And this is why I like VNW. It just makes sense. Can this help you in your technology?
No.
Why not?
The process,
kid.
Excuse me?
The process.
You're not talking about the brick. You're talking about the process.
I was thinking about this.
I'm not talking about the brick. But Value Innovations, is this something that would be of benefit to you?
It could be.
Okay. Can I have your paper back?
Sure.
Mike, talk about a not-for-profit. You see this applying? Does it have to be a for-profit corporation?
I'm sorry, but I'm hard of hearing. I don't understand your question.
Okay. So I'm thinking about an institute of higher education, for instance. Is this being used in not-for-profits as well as manufacturing, as well as for-profits?
Yes.
There's an answer? Sure. Do you have any examples?
I do a lot of confidential stuff.
Okay.
There are cities that I work with where we're meeting with the economic development people, mm-hmm. where we're meeting with the manufacturers in the city, where we're trying to increase their jobs and their things. We have different educational institutions who want to use this for really purposes that are a little bit different than the goal. But they are looking at it, they've gone through the classes, they're trying to figure out how do they use that with their educational goals.
Right.
We've got the teachers union, a meeting set up for them, where they're fighting all sorts of political battles over political issues which we're not involved with. But we have volunteers who work in the union who want us to do a presentation there, because if we put a manufacturer or save a manufacturer in a rural town, we want that manufacturer or that company to show the students locally that they can stay here and develop their own businesses. Does that help?
Kind of.
Well, on the non-for-profit side, not disclosing who, but have you helped them improve fundraising, improve their streamlined operations, their organization? Conceptually, what have you helped a non-for-profit do? or improve through?
We have been approached by a statewide not-for-profit that's education, and we have told them that certain things they are thinking of doing are illegal. And they didn't understand the law. And what their goal was a reasonable goal, but you don't want to go do something. And here's, I think I can say the perfect example about saying who. You've got classrooms that are open because student populations in some areas have dropped. So they said, hey, we want to put an incubator into the classroom. Well, they wanted to charge the company much lower rent rate than what was available commercially. Can't do that. And their perspective was, an incubator is we just rent space. So I spent 3 hours going over, these are the services an incubator provides, and these are the things that you've got to do to help that company grow. If you just want to rent, go ahead, but you have to rent at current market rates, which they didn't want to do. And they said, well, we've already got somebody working in our basement. I said, don't tell me. So those are some of the things that we get involved with other not-for-profits.
Let me ask an entirely different question. New question.
Okay.
If we had interest in the area in going through a two-day workshop, would you go through the process with everybody in the workshop of identifying your most important customers? Do you actually go through the steps
Absolutely.
With them?
Okay. Absolutely. The entire program takes 12 to 15 weeks. We would go through the entire thing with you. And I stopped just before getting to a breakout session.
Uh-huh.
And that breakout session where we'd break you up into different groups, we would now provide you with some more options to start deciding, what do I do in this situation? It would be a situation that really doesn't apply to anybody in the room, but it makes you think through the steps so you see what the concept is.
I'm thinking the term value innovation is very interesting. To me, it was appealing. You happen to be on my campus, and my office happens to be presenting you today. So, of course, I'm here. I think there are people not here who could not identify as clearly with the term. And so, in my head, I'm thinking, you know, this is a really nice process and kind of simple. I mean, you can get a lot done in 2 days. And I'm just... And Marv's shaking his head because this is a project for Marv, but you know, I'm thinking, and I guess I should be asking Sherry and others, how could you market this to have people understand the value of value innovation?
See, the only part I understood about that was the word innovation.
Yeah.
You know, and that's what attracted me to come today, is because you're going to talk about innovation.
Yeah.
Value innovation, I'm going, what's this value innovation? Innovation, I understood.
Now I understand it, and I like it. You know, I think it. What do you think?
I think for me, listening to this, I think I know who my most important customer is. You've made me think, well, maybe I don't, but I really feel I do. So my question is, would there be value in a two-day workshop if I already know who my most important customer is?
I would. Want you to think that other step forward. I would say that if you have clearly defined your most important customer, by the definition, mm-hmm. typically has this, I would do some contextual interviewing with them, look in the book and ask the question, and see if you can look for and identify their unmet needs. If they have unmet needs, they should come out in that contextual interviewing. And let me give you a perfect example. I've been on the phone, so I wear a headset, thank God, and I've been listening to these contextual interviews. Catheterization for blockage of arteries is a major issue. And we were listening to Dick Lee talk to companies or talk to people who do that catheterization so they could design the catheter in a much more appropriate fashion. The two people are talking back and forth, and they agree that this modification for the catheter must be made because it was relevant to both of them. Now, he says that we should use 12 most important customers, and you may not have 12 most important customers, but I would say talk to your customers using those questions, because those questions are broad in the beginning, and you can get them talking. If you don't feel comfortable reaching out, I talk to anybody. I will work with you on setting up those discussions, we'll record those discussions, and we'll put their comments down so we can see whether or not there are unmet needs with your customers. Let's say there are unmet needs your customers and there are modifications you can make for your product. You're going to make more sales coming through your customers because they just told you what they wanted.
So identifying the most important customer is actually the first step in driving down to what their needs are and then looking back at my operations and how I can modify my procedures, my products, my marketing, my distribution, so that now I'm 100% addressing their needs, which have come from a multitude of people, not just one or two comments from one or two customers. What you're presenting here is kind of step one, but we've got to drive down to now, how do we talk to your customers to find out what is the right end mill, you know, to, you know, make your process, manufacturing process, more efficient, but to...
Well, it's funny because how we've developed our business is kind of like we did fill the need that was unmet, but I love to be challenged if I could be better. I am curious if this process could challenge all the things that I think are already in place. You know, we've gone after a niche market, filling a need, a value that's not currently being met by my competition. But again, you know, could this, you know, I mean, as any business owner, you're going to weigh, okay, can what am I going to get out of investing 2 days? That's where I am. Am I going to get the value out? Is there enough here that I'm going to walk away with two?
You're in a specialty which has tremendous opportunity. Since you and I have communicated, I looked up your information on LinkedIn. Mm-hmm. There's a ton of things you can do with your product. I don't think you're doing them all.
Probably not.
So if you can see other options that you can do with your product today and expand your sales, I want you to hire more people.
So here's the question. In a two-day seminar, can Sherry get something specific to her, specific enough to her industry to make it worth investing the 2 days?
What she would get from the two-day seminar would be a thorough comprehension of the entire process. And the process would be, the first step, at the end of the two-day class, she has to take the project sheet and go back and work with her people and define what your goal is. Okay, you define what your goal is, what your timeline is, what do you want to do? Okay, and from that point on, after defining that, we then go to the next step and we start looking at the contextual interviews and setting them up.
The problem I see with that whole thing is you're making the assumption that your customers know what they really want. I've had customers in the past that really, they think they know what they need, but they really don't.
Well, in the contextual interviewing that I listened to for the catheters, you're quite correct that some of the physicians who did the catheter insert, and we were talking about arteries that were filled with plaque. They were not sure what they did want, but when you look at the consensus of the 12, you could see the most common issue that was common with the great majority. And you're right. When I was with Organogenesis, I spent $100,000 on doing product interviews with scientists who had never heard of the product before, never seen it before, and we wasted $100,000 on scientists in New Jersey. They didn't know what to do with it because they haven't seen it. This is different because we've got an existing product, and you've got people that you talk to where if you and I are in the same specialty and we're on the phone together and you say, Mike, I'd like to see this particular change. Now, Mike agrees with you on that change. I may not have thought of it, but we're listening and we're recording it. And if other most important customers say, oh, I like that idea, I want to make that change also, you're a prospect for me modifying my product to meet your needs.
Now, I'm puzzled still, and we talked about this by email. I'm a sole proprietor. I am everything, okay? And every single customer I have, the few that I have, are my very important customers. Every single one of them. If I don't have that money coming in, then I go out of business. And one talks to another, and I get business by referrals.
Okay, tell them what you do.
I do voiceovers. I'm a professional talent, and I provide my voice for companies or individuals or organizations to showcase their products, whether it be for commercials or for corporate presentations or things like audiovisual things. Or I tell children's stories. Wide things that I do. Every single customer is important to me.
Okay, but the things that I sent you were, you need a partner. When I deal with startups and I have an entrepreneur here with a great idea, that entrepreneur oftentimes isn't the enterpriser.
Well, in our industry is an agent, and getting an agent is not easy because they're in New York and they're in LA, and they want you to be there.
Are you partnered with a woman's voice?
No.
And that was another one of the recommendations I made to them is do have two voices part of this. I went to the classes for voiceover. I have the type of voice where if I ever do pornographic phone calls, all my friends will say, Mike, we know that's you. people kept saying, do commercial. So I went through the whole thing, and I understand the process. I think you need to have a partner who is enterprising. I wouldn't call it an agent. You might find somebody in here who says, hey, let me work with you on the marketing issue. Do you have CDs? Do you send out CDs? Do you make those phone calls? Or maybe you don't like to do that. Maybe you only like to do the voiceovers.
I see what you mean. Yeah.
I'm hoping I can change your thinking because you built this roadblock where.
Well, it's just because I've been doing it for so long. There's a lot of things that go that happen in our industry, and there's politics that prevent or help you get work, and there's unions that are involved, and there are a lot of little nooks and crannies that you have to kind of weave around.
Okay, but
to do your business. But the customer, your most important customer, that's where I'm focusing on. My most important customer, there isn't one.
Well, don't think of it as a specific customer.
Well, that's what.
Think of it as
maybe that's what the definition needs to be broadened so we can understand what it is.
Customers. So it's not a specific Joe or Fred.
See,
it's
that's
a classification of customers.
Okay, now I get it.
How about somebody? Would you sign it? How about somebody else? And Mark, what do you think? Can you see the county or the state or some of our local? How can you see this being used?
I don't know.
I mean, I'm just in a small, I work, for the Department of Labor, I work for the state, which is huge, but my office is two people.
Right.
So I don't see, and our customers, we really don't know how it would work for us. I think more of a, like a real business, I don't think of like a government entity, doing this. I don't know.
have a question. Is this strictly related? It feels as though it's related mostly to sales and marketing. Now, when I heard value innovation, I'm thinking of it as a much broader scale that I can maybe use something I learned to fix a problem within my organization.
I tried to address that issue with Chevron, looking inside of their corporation, only talking to those guys who did the drilling to prove their amount of oil that they came out of their current situation. This can be inside or outside. Now, let me answer your question a little bit. When we look at the number of companies and the cascading of jobs going down over the last 4 years, I wish I had this program so that I could work with those companies as they started going down. My father made silverware out of an Island Limited.
You too.
Okay.
I worked
there. You
And the issue, and I remember it well because one of my summer jobs for Night Limited, I don't tell too many people this, was I dug graves in the Night Limited graveyard to bury the last members of the socialist community. When you're poor, you do anything.
Gotcha.
But the issue with the Night Limited was they never updated their equipment to compete with the overseas area. The Noyes family, okay, didn't do a lot of the things to keep that company competitive. And what this process will do and what we will do is we walk in. Right now we're entertaining something in Rochester. It will cost the company $700,000. And there's detailed discussion. There are thousands of jobs at stake. They know this works. So, if we can do this in Rochester, I really want to do it in Utica because Utica needs it more so than anybody else, and nobody cares about Utica.
Well, nobody cares.
You know what I mean.
I know exactly what you mean.
I have relatives who are multi-degree relatives, and the best job they can get is $45,000. Go to Boston and they make $100,000.
So I'm putting my entrepreneurial hat on. I'm putting Mark's entrepreneurial hat on. and thinking, you know, could we attract enough probably small businesses, so we do it with the SBDC, to hold here a 2-day seminar,
yep,
possibly followed up with consulting or however you follow it up, and attract enough people who could understand the value of value innovation. And that's why I'm so glad you're sitting here, because I think you're kind of going through the same process.
Yeah, I think what I would need, in all honesty, to commit is I would probably need to have a conversation, a more thorough conversation where I'm not taking up everybody's time in the room just about my company, but to have maybe a half-hour conversation to really determine if it is worth investing 2 days.
Who you would bring? Because maybe it isn't just you. Maybe there's somebody else.
Possibly, yeah.
So that's
the hard part of being a small company.
It is.
You can't. You let go of anybody for 2 days. Your business shuts down if you do that.
Well, see, we will do this on a Saturday and Sunday because we recognize that. You can go to Denver and go through the class with Dick Lee. He doesn't do it on weekends. He charges, for his 2-day class, $2,265. We would probably charge something for a 2-day class because we'd have to buy breakfast and lunch and things like that. But it would be nothing close to that, but we'd want to cover cost of some sort. If you want people to talk to, Dick Lee right now is in Wisconsin University putting on a class. And I think they have 55 people from companies who have gone there to go through the process.
We should look at how they reached out to people.
Where else in the state have you done two-day classes?
I'm sorry.
Where else in your state have you done a two-day class?
Since I rolled this out 14 weeks ago, I've only done the classes that you see here. I have 2-day classes that will be going on in Albany. I am looking at Rochester and looking at Buffalo, but I'd like to have 10 companies to do a class.
Okay.
And I don't have 10 companies yet in Albany, very close, but I don't have 10 companies in Albany who want to do the 2-day class. Dick Lee has done a ton of it. He's done over 180 companies, and he does classes, 2-day classes, I think, 4 or 6 times a year. And we're rolling out into universities because this issue really, we need to tie academia into business in this way. You have a company here who I desperately tried to get to this class, ConMed.
Yeah.
My background's medical.
Yeah.
They're now faced with their products going into generic bidding groups. Well, hello, less work on value innovation, less work on making your product unique. You are now generic, let's make it not generic, let's make it unique to ConMed so that we don't have to put it into bidding groups, so that our surgeons or whoever it is wants this particular product. And that's the issue that we bring up. I can't tell you I know how to do it, but I can tell you your customer knows how to do it.
Has Well-Challenge done this?
Excuse me?
Has Well-Challenge done this?
We actually contacted Well-Challenge to join us on other issues, and they did not return the phone calls.
About AngioDynamics?
AngioDynamics is actually up the road from us, and we have not contacted them.
Okay, we've got to wrap this up in a couple minutes, because there'll be a class they send you in here in a little bit of time, so we need to get out of their way. Obviously, Michael's been in contact, I think, with most of you. If he hasn't been in contact with you, give him your business card or whatever so that he can. So you can continue the conversation one-on-one once you leave here today. Now, where can folks get the book? If people are interested in the book, where is the book available? The book.
The book is available on Amazon.com, but I also brought some. If you want the book and don't have the money, I'll give it to you. If you buy it from Amazon.com, you pay $28. If you buy it from me, and you've got $20, it'll be $20 for no call later. This is why I actually wanted to read the book, because the content here is the important thing. I'm not. The content. So, Amazon.com, or this is why I bring books.